Welcome to a presentation on definite integrals and the fundamental theorem of calculus. A definite integral is equal to the limit of this sum. Remember, this sum was the same sum we were using to find the approximate area under a curve by using rectangles. So the limit as the number of rectangles approaches infinity is equal to this definite integral from a to b. Note that the notation for the definite integral is very similar to the notation for an indefinite integral. The number a at the bottom of the integral sign is called the lower limit of integration, and the b at the top is called the upper limit of integration. Often a and b are called the interval of integration. If f of x is non-negative and continuous, the definite integral will equal the area bounded by the function and the x-axis on the interval from a to b. Let's pause for a moment and take a look at the differences between an indefinite integral and a definite integral. First off, they look identical except this one has limits of integration, the values of a and b. Remember that an indefinite integral returns an antiderivative, or a function, whose derivative is equal to f of x. It also returns a family of functions, so there's a plus c on the end. And again, notice there are no limits of integration. When we evaluate a definite integral, we will get a numerical value, which may or may not represent area depending on if the function is non-negative and continuous. And again, notice the limits of integration. So let's return to the idea of a definite integral. If we take a look at this green shaded region, if we want to find the area, we can now define it as a definite integral in this form, where a and b represent the interval of integration, or in this case, the interval for which we're considering the area. Just keep in mind, this is only true when the function is non-negative and continuous over the interval from a to b. So for example, if we wanted to consider the area bounded by the graph f of x is equal to the square root of 4 minus x squared from negative 2 to 2, since this area is a semicircle, we can calculate the area using a geometric formula. We would have an area of 2 pi square units. Therefore, we can now rewrite this using a definite integral, where our integrand would be the square root of 4 minus x squared, with our interval of integration from negative 2 to positive 2. And this would have the value of 4 pi, which would represent the area of the shaded region. Now we come to one of the most powerful theorems of calculus called the fundamental theorem of calculus. If a function f is continuous on the closed interval a to b and f is the antiderivative of the function f, then we can evaluate this definite integral by evaluating the antiderivative at b and subtracting the value of the antiderivative at a. This is a very powerful and useful theorem. I don't have time to prove it here, but I recommend you visiting this website. It has a nice animation of the proof of this theorem. So here are the guidelines for using the fundamental theorem of calculus. Provided we can find the antiderivative of f of x, we now have a way to evaluate a definite integral without having to use a limit of a sum. When we apply the fundamental theorem of calculus, the following notation will be convenient. We'll find the antiderivative, then we'll evaluate it at b, evaluate it at a, and then find the difference. You may be wondering where the c went. It's not necessary to include the constant of integration c in the antiderivative because f of b would have a plus c and so would f of a, and therefore the c's would cancel. Let's go and see how this is going to work. Let's find the area under the curve over the indicated interval. Again, the function is continuous and non-negative, therefore we can find the area by evaluating a definite integral on the interval from 0 to 4. That would give us our limits of integration. Our integrand, or the function that we're considering, is x squared plus 1. And then we don't want to forget the dx on the end. So what the fundamental theorem of calculus says is what we can do is find the antiderivative using the power rule, add 1 to the exponent, divide by the new exponent. The antiderivative of 1 would give us x. And now we need to evaluate this at the x values of 4 and 0. So let's first evaluate this when x is 4, and then we're going to subtract the value of this when x is 0. Well, of course, this would be 0, so we're going to have 4 cubed divided by 3. That would be 64 thirds plus 4. Well, 4 would be 12 thirds, so we'd have 76 thirds, which would equal to 25 and 1 third. So this is quite powerful. We're able to find the exact area under this function on the interval from 0 to 4 using the fundamental theorem of calculus, and it's quite amazing how simple it is. Now, there is a way to check our work on the graphing calculator for definite integrals. And what we do is we enter the integrand, or the function, into y1. Now, I've already adjusted the window to make it match the window that we're viewing here. So I'm going to hit graph. Now, if I hit second trace, which brings up the calculation menu, and then option 7, it will ask me for the lower limit of integration and then the upper. So the lower limit would be 0, enter. The upper would be 4, enter. And it's nice that it actually shades the region, and then it gives us the decimal approximation. 25.3 repeating, of course, is 25 and 1/3, which verifies our work. Let's go ahead and try another. Again, the function is continuous and positive on the interval from 1 to 4. So we can set up our definite integral. The area would equal the definite integral from 1 to 4. Our integrand is 2 divided by x, and we're integrating with respects to x. Now, I could factor out this 2. The antiderivative of 1 over x would be the natural log of the absolute value of x. And we need to evaluate this at 4 and 1. I didn't include the absolute value because our interval is positive already. So our area will equal 2 natural log 4 minus 2 natural log of 1. If you remember, natural log of 1 would be 0. Therefore, our area would equal 2 natural log 4. Let's go ahead and try another. I could apply some properties of integration here, but I'm going to go ahead and find the antiderivative in its current form. So we'd have 2 times x squared divided by 2 from the power rule minus 2 times x cubed divided by 3. And we need to evaluate this at 2 and 0. But before we do that, let's clean this up. We would have x squared minus 2 thirds x cubed evaluated at 2 and 0. So we first evaluate at x equals 2 minus, now when we sub in a 0 for x, both of these will be 0. So here we're going to have 4 minus 2 thirds times 8, which is equal to negative 4 thirds. So right away, recognize this can't be area because, of course, area would be positive. So to fully interpret the results, let's go ahead and take a look at the graph. And we can see this function is not positive on the interval from 0 to 2. Notice how from 1 to 2 it's negative. So in fact, when we evaluate the definite integral from 1 to 2, we get a negative value. And when we integrate from 0 to 1, we get a positive value. What we can conclude, though, is that the area below the x-axis is more than the area above, since the result was negative. But the most obvious conclusion would be that the value of this definite integral does not represent the area bounded by the function and the x-axis. Let's take a look at one more application. We know from past studies that when we find the derivative of the position function, we get the velocity function. And when we find the derivative of the velocity function, we get the acceleration function. Well, now we can use integration to undo this process, meaning if we have the velocity function, we can integrate and find the position function. And if we integrate the acceleration function, we'll get the velocity function. Let's apply this. We want to find the position function s of t when the velocity function is equal to 6t squared, and we know that s of 0 is equal to 4. As just stated, if we want to find the position function, we could find the antiderivative of the velocity function with respects to t. So if we apply the power rule, we would add 1 to 2, and we'd have 6 times t to the third divided by 3 plus c, which would give us 2t cubed plus c. But we are given that s of 0 is equal to 4, so if we replace t with 0, we must get a value of 4, Well, this is 0, so we can determine that c would be equal to 4. Therefore, our exact position function, or our particular position function, would be equal to 2t cubed plus 4. Thank you for watching.